Hello, subscribers. Good afternoon. It's a sunny Monday afternoon here in Sydney. It's 4:26 p.m. It's March 13, 2017. Before I start, I would like to first acknowledge Marcus Aurelius. He was an emperor of the Roman Empire, and despite being in a position of power, he practiced Stoicism, and it is his writings in meditations that allow us to have an idea or an understanding of what Stoicism means. And I'm so humbled by how, even if he is the most powerful man in the Roman Empire, he always thinks about losing it all. So his meditations is, who will I be if I don't have all of this? So it's just an interesting counterpoint to the culture that we have. Thank you, Marcus. Okay, so let me just add one more thing, or maybe there will be more, but for now, I'll just add one more thing to the topic of identity. So earlier this afternoon, I was sitting in Centrelink in Redfern. So for people who aren't from Australia, Centrelink is a government agency that handles benefits. So they handle the money you get if you're unemployed, if you're a student, if you have a disability, and they also give allowances to mothers and all that. So interestingly enough, so I was sitting there, it takes a while to be served. So I was sitting there and I couldn't help but overhear the conversation of the people sitting behind me. It was between the caseworker, so this guy was helping the other guy, and they were quite loud, so I just couldn't help it but overhear what they were saying. So from what I could gather, what happened was the guy, the client of the caseworker, lost his or his Centrelink payment stopped because he couldn't provide identification documents. So I would gather that maybe nowadays you have to reprove, like if you're getting benefits, you have to every now and then show your identification documents. So I just would like to start with that. So on one hand, I understand from the point of view of the accountants or the controllers of the government budget, they want controls, right? So they want to check that people who claim benefits are real people, right? So they ask for identification, which makes sense from their point of view. Now, on the other side, the client side, it's interesting because most of the people who need benefits are the people who are not likely to, for one reason or another, there are many reasons why this happens, and I don't pretend to understand what are these reasons. I'm not an expert on this, but from what I saw, just observing everyone in that big room, most of the people who need benefits would find it hard to have documentation, or we find it very easy to lose this documentation. So there's like a disconnect there. Like you're putting the burden on someone to prove who they are, where they are the type of person that has fallen out of the system, right? So if you're out of the system, it's most likely that you're not documented, because otherwise you would be in the system. So this is an interesting design challenge. So this is like service design. You have competing, because however you design a product or a service, there will always be competing needs and wants. So it doesn't make sense to design a product for everyone, because no such product does not exist. And if that product exists, then it will be the lowest common denominator in order to satisfy everyone. So like in the tech world, most of the people who innovated, who created fantastic products, really they just created it from themselves, right? So like the guy who invented, who made Hotmail, which is the start of the webmail, he was working in a company and he wanted to do something on the side. They were working on a startup on the side, but the other guy he was working with was in another company. And during that time, there's no webmail. So they didn't want to use the, because then the emails are controlled by the system administrators of the company you're working for. So they didn't want to be known. So at that time, there was a time, the younger people would not believe, but there was a time that the only email you could have is either a university or a company email. There was no such thing as personal email, really. So they just had they just wanted to solve their problem. And that's how Hotmail started. They just found a way, oh, what can we do to enable this? So there's loads of stories like that. So what I'm saying is, there are needs and they're competing. And these are the challenges. And there's always that chicken and egg problem, right? So you need documentation in order to account for the money being disbursed to people. But then the fact that they need this money is more likely that they don't have these things because they don't have a job or they don't have records or they have problems, which makes it likely that, or like many of them will be homeless. So there's no cabinets to keep all your paper documents. But these are the challenging aspects of product or service design. And it would be interesting to see, because there's already a lot of people working for private companies, big companies. Design is becoming a big thing, but I don't have the statistics. But if I would guess, a large proportion of it would be of these designers are working for the big companies, who in a way don't really need it, because they're relatively already have enough designers there. And a lot of people are competing for those jobs. So it creates this huge competition. So a lot of designers would be out of work because they can't all work for Google. But that's where they want to work. Whereas there's this whole, the rest of society that could benefit from a design thinking or a designer's way of tackling challenges and problems. So maybe a couple of weeks ago, I was listening to this podcast or videocast, and it was Jennifer Palka from Code for America, which is an amazing program where they take the brilliant engineers who work in the big companies in Silicon Valley and have them work for government. So they're trying to fix government using the same brilliance that they've done to get rid of the frictions that we have whenever we interact with e-commerce or with, you know, the beautiful, in the old days they call it web 2.0 apps. It hasn't really trickled to really big businesses, although it's starting to, and governments. Like in America, I think it really became, Code for America became really important during the Obama administration, when they had Obamacare, they spent ridiculous amounts of money. I don't know if it's billions or millions for a website that failed miserably. So you had to redo it from scratch. So I'm just saying that if there are designers out there, or student designers, maybe instead of focusing all your effort, who am I to tell you, but I'm just giving you some ideas if you want. It's just, I myself, I'm beginning to think, what can I do in this space? Because it's, you know, instead of, I forgot who said this, but a lot of the most brilliant, it's so sad that the most brilliant minds of our generation are all thinking of how to get the next click, you know, because they're hiring all these top mathematicians, physicists, economists, whatever, to maximize clicking in the web for advertising, which is sad. Or in the same manner, we have all these brilliant physicists being hired by hedge funds and high-frequency trading companies in order to maximize how fast you can turn over the stock exchange, which in a way destroys the whole thing, because how can a human out-trade a machine? So it becomes just like a big game of who has the most, who has the fastest CPU wins. So it's no longer reflecting the real economy, right? It's just because by definition, derivatives are derivatives. You know, when these derivative financial instruments, they are derived from the underlying real asset, and they're derivatives of derivatives. And it just goes crazy that the derivative, the value of these things, financial instruments that are derived from the real thing, far outweighs the actual value. So like, they're like, I don't know the figure, but it's like a lot of times the real economy. And it goes for commodities as well. So you have commodities like oil, coffee, pork bellies. They make instruments, futures, future contracts for this. And there's a lot of trading happening, paper trading, that doesn't really, it's tied to loosely to the actual good, but the goods are not delivered to the person owning the paper. And most of the action in terms of exchange of profits and losses happen in the paper in this world. So if you were following these podcasts and also the other podcast on complex humans, this is another it's not symptom, it's another way, manifestation of how the world is getting less solid, it's getting less liquid. So a lot of money that's changing hands are happening in between computers, and they're happening using instruments that are one or more steps away from the real thing. And I'm not a fundamentalist by any means. I'm not saying that all of those things are bad. They have their uses. But at the same time, it's not all good. So for those of you who are fans of science fiction, there's usually the polar opposites of science fiction. There's the dystopia, where everything's fucked up, everything's a mess because of technology, you know, like genetic engineering resulted in Gattaca, or genetic profiling to be more exact, and children of men, like people can have kids, and all those things. So bad things happen when technology becomes too fast, or it becomes like too big or too predominant in society. That's mostly this dystopian science fiction. On the other side are the utopian science fiction. And to be honest, this, I'm pressed to come up from the top of my head. It's funny, the caricature I have in my head is the Jetsons. You know, it's hard really to point to a particular utopian science fiction. I think it was Peter Thiel who said that we're anti-progress now, anti-science, because all of the culture, all of the literature are dystopian, heavily dystopian. There's not many utopian fiction, unlike he said in the 70s, where 60s, where we will go to the moon, or we'll go to space, and they did it, you know, and then they had the Manhattan Project, we will craft the atom. So at that time, it was all positive towards science, progress, and they thought we'll have flying cars by now, we would do time travel. Oh yeah, maybe those are the utopian ones, like H.G. Wells and all those fiction, science fiction about time travel. They were so positive about what we can achieve with all this science and technology. Now, my friend Marcus, who was in the other episode of Complex Humans, would like this. So in between the centrist thing between dystopia and utopia would be technological realism. And one of my favorite TV series of all time is the reimagining. So I'm gonna wrap up soon and finish with technological realism. One of my favorite TV shows ever was the reimagining of Battlestar Galactica, and there it's really technological realism. Like they portrayed it, there's no whiz bang crazy shit. It's like hard science. Like it's one of the shows where they're so real that when you see explosion, you know, in some science fiction, when things explode in space, there's sound. But actually, there shouldn't be sound because there are no air molecules in space. So in Battlestar Galactica, when that happens, it's silent. So it's quite realistic. And then also because with Battlestar Galactica, it's not really, it's like one of these shows like Walking Dead and all these great shows. It's not really about the space, it's about the people, really. It's like the complexity of it. I was thinking like if I was an academic, I could do a whole course, a whole subject on the philosophy and ethics involved in Battlestar Galactica. So I could do that in future episodes if this off the cuff talking takes us there. But this, it's so rich. The episodes of that series are so rich in answering, on actually not answering but posing the questions: what does it mean to be human, what is consciousness, what is God, what is life. You know, it's an amazing series. So I'll end on that, and thank you for, if you're continuing to watch this, I'm really grateful for you watching this. And if you find that you find something of value by watching, please share to your friends and to your social media. And if you found this through the gods of serendipity, please subscribe below using in my YouTube channel so you can be informed when future episodes happen. All right, folks, live long and prosper.